morning, everybody. First of all, I would like to thank Keystep for inviting me and giving me this platform to speak in front of speakers who have spoken previously. I'm fortunate, like Professor Robert, Professor Alpo, and today Professor Levine, and other distinguished speakers. But the topic for today is global challenges in sustainable water management. So the brief outline is, first, very briefly, I would like to show the global water scenario and sustainable development goals. Then the overview of, so to give the global scenario very briefly, as we see in this map, in 1975, water scarcity was limited to small number of countries in North Africa, Europe, and the Middle East. By 2000, the water scarcity had spread to many large and densely populated countries in Asia. The water-stressed countries are marked in yellow here. And if we go to the next slide, by 2025, we see that it's increasing, and countries which had surplus water would now move to the abundant category. Countries which had abundant water are moving towards the adequate category. So this is by 2025. So this is the global per capita water availability. So keeping this at the background, today in the morning we had listened a lot about the sustainable development goals. And so the international community had felt the need to address this sector, and clean water and sanitation was in goal 6. Besides this, the World Water Day is celebrated since 1993 to address the issues around it. So everyone is concerned on it. So coming to the case of India, in India what happens is the links between water consumption across sector complicates the water management a lot. We know that generally there are three sectors: agricultural production, industrial production, domestic consumption. And India is the leading crop producer country, so a lot of water consumption towards agriculture. Coming to the water related challenges in India, there are several of them, but if I want to tell about one of them, like the low per capita availability. Although the government statistics may show that yes, more than 90% of the households are covered with domestic water facilities, but the real situation is like people have to travel in remote places from 2 to 3 kilometers to fetch water. Then water is not available during the acute summer months. So there is real scarcity. Moreover, you know that this geological contamination is affecting India throughout. Like arsenic, fluoride is very widespread. It was spreading in the country. Previously, it was restricted to two states, but now that is increasing. And adding to it, there are several others. Let's skip this. So how the STI scenario I'd like to come now. There are several ministries, and several ministries have got research laboratories under them who are undertaking water research. And this was a study done which took all the funding of all the ministries, and it came out, like you can see here, DST is the Department of Science and Technology and the Ministry of Science and Technology. CSI is an autonomous society from where we come from. All these are funding bodies which I put here: Ministry of Water Resources, Ministry of Environment, Forest, DRDO, Department of Atomic Energy, ISRO, DBT, that's Department of Biotechnology, and these are the two higher education bodies. All of them are funding for water research, and what comes out is this: over the last 10 years, that water quality had received maximum number of projects. And wastewater treatment is not so much gaining attention. But to mention here, India has come policy in the 80s, which was then updated in 2002 and lately in 2012. And in the water policy, we have scope for S&T intervention, wherein they say that wastewater treatment technology should be highly promoted, but from this, we don't find such coherence. This is the trend of allocation of funds related to water availability to universities, R&D institutes and others. So here university needs, maybe because the universities have lesser funds for research, whereas the other R&D institutes, they have got their own fund. This shows the universities, amongst the universities, again the state universities are the largest receiver of the funds. To mention here, these funds are basically project based. So whoever is applying for the project are getting the funds. And these projects, this study showed was for a period of 2 to 3 years. And we had tried to see that whether these projects were renewed or continued, very less of them had been, it was observed that were renewed or continued. So in an attempt to conserve water, India has launched numerous programs but lacks an independent regulator. This multiplicity of organization, then although we have the water policy, but there are other policies which do not take care of it, like we don't have, there is inadequate legislation on exploitation of groundwater still after having so much of problems on arsenic and fluoride. We do not have who can pump the groundwater, how much and for what purpose. This is a basket of technologies that on water quality that CSIR had developed. Almost 16 to 17 laboratories out of 38 are working on water related technologies. These technologies have been piloted, but very less of them have been commercialized. So there are other initiatives that are taken, that are also taking place with under CSR. Corporates are also coming up. This is the state councils. We, India being a federal country, the state councils are there, which are also undertaking some water related S&T interventions. These are various states who are doing it. There is some initiatives that is happening on regulations for rainwater conservation, laws for interstate water sharing or linking. Then civil society organizations are increasingly playing a greater role in water, sustainable water management in India. So coming to the last part, that how can now collaboration help? Of course, sharing knowledge and expertise, learning from each other's experience, and perhaps there's a need to develop sustainable water resource indicators at the present, which I think this forum can deliberate upon and take it forward, because without proper indicators, if all countries have indicators in place and they do it simultaneously, it would enable better informed policy making. So there's a need for a framework for tackling and understanding changes to the health of its fresh and coastal water, surface and groundwater, wetlands and watersheds. The framework, there's also a need for framework for understanding the sustainability of these changes long term for ecosystems and communities. So what key issues could be addressed are, what are the important questions to ask to determine the degree to which the nation is on a sustainable course in its true and in its use and management of water resources. And last, the one point that I want to highlight, how can a set of indicators be developed that is large enough to be comprehensive but small enough to be readily understandable and practical? Regarding this, there have been models that is developed in the US, and which means the work is on, so the Asian countries can come together, because Asia is facing the water challenge, and deliberate on building some indicators collaboratively. Thank you.